school.
I used to talk a lot in class. I used to get in trouble for talking. And I had really gotten into the doghouse with a particular teacher because of all my talking. And she had gotten on to me for talking too much and not paying attention in class. And so I had in my mind that I was going to do everything right. And I was going to get ready for class and have everything ready and be the most prepared person. I'm going to go beyond being prepared. And so I looked at the homework that we had that night. I got prepared. I wrote down everything. And she had a way of going down the line and asking questions for homework so that she would start at the front of the class on this row and begin to go down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so I knew what question I was going to be asked. And so I knew, I looked down, I found all of my work that I had gone through, and I knew, counting down, what the answer was going to be for me. I saw that I was number 7, and I saw that the answer to number 7 was going to be the Missouri Compromise. That was the answer. And I was proud because I was prepared. And I wasn't talking, I was prepared. I was going to get out of the doghouse. And so she starts down, and I'm just watching. And it got to me, and she said, "Tim, the answer," and I said, "The Missouri Compromise," expecting cheers, you know. People carry me around the classroom, hold me up. And I heard the teacher say, "Well, that's right for number 7, Tim, but we're on number 8 now, catch up." And I realized I had miscounted. And I didn't even pay attention to the answer had just been given. I had dreamed my answer would deliver me from the doghouse. Then I totally missed it. Peter came to Jesus. He had felt like he was in the doghouse ever since he had that moment with Jesus. Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan. That'll put you in the doghouse." Most of the rabbis who were more liberal in their thinking about mercy were teaching at the time that you should forgive somebody up to 3 times. So Peter, in his mind, is going to get out of the doghouse, you see. He's going to double what the rabbis are saying and add 1, 7. And he goes to Jesus and he says, "How many times should we forgive?" 7 times? But Jesus answered quickly, reminded Peter that they were already way past 7. Forgiveness permeates the teachings of Jesus. The story that he told of the prodigal. Remember how that father ran out and embraced his son to forgive him. Remember the time in the scriptures where the woman was caught in adultery and brought before Jesus. They were going to stone her, and he said, "Ye without sin, cast the first stone," and everybody put their stones down and walked away. And he said to the woman, "What? Where are your accusers?" And they said, "They are gone." He said, "Neither do I condemn you, but go no more." Remember the story? There was a time when judgmental Pharisees were really concerned that Jesus was eating with sinners and tax collectors. And he quoted Hosea back to them and said, "Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice." In the Lord's Prayer, we pray, "Forgive us our trespasses." What? As we forgive those who? As we forgive those. Forgiveness literally means to give before. It means to let go of what you have even before someone else. And for the follower of Jesus, it's not an option. It's a must. And it's very difficult at times. And it takes faith to practice forgiveness. It takes faith that God can work with. In the Exodus passage we heard today, the people of Israel were trapped between Pharaoh and the Red Sea. Talk about no place to go. And they're watching the chariots of Pharaoh in the distance, that cloud of dust coming. The chariots of Egypt at that time were the top military intelligence of its day. And Egypt had it all. And here they came. Behind them, the Red Sea, and they've no place to go. So they did the only thing that they could do. They complained to Moses. There weren't enough graves in Egypt that you brought us out here. We told you to let us serve the Egyptians. At least we wouldn't be dying out here. And Moses responds in what seems to be a faithful response. Do not be afraid. Good word. Don't be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring to you today. He concludes with, you only need to be still. I used to read that and think, wow, what faith. But then I caught God's answer to Moses. Did you catch what God said to Moses? I'm going to paraphrase it. Moses, why are you crying out to me? Why are you telling the people to be still? Tell them to get up and go. Tell them to go. Tell them to go. God was indeed going to act, but it would be through the faithful obedience of Israel. If Israel had not acted in faith, the story would be different. So it is with all aspects of obedience, including forgiveness. God is interested in the deliverance of people. And a great means of deliverance is through the act of forgiveness. And it takes faith to offer forgiveness. What if the person doesn't respond the way I hope they do? What if I don't believe the person deserves forgiveness? What if that person has sinned against me 70 times? What if I don't feel like it? Yet Jesus prescribes his followers to forgive 70 times 7. I had one youth one time tell me this in a group setting. We were talking about this scripture, and the youth said, basically, we can stop forgiving others when Christ stops offering forgiveness, right? I said, I think you got it. I think you've got it. But it takes faith to do that. It takes faith. It takes getting up and going. And then watching God work through our obedience. We might be called upon to offer forgiveness even when we don't feel like it. Even if we feel that that person doesn't deserve it. But yet, we are commanded by Christ to always be willing to offer forgiveness as one who has already received forgiveness. Why? Because acting in faith, that God begins to act in other people's lives and in our own. Jesus tells in the scripture today the story of the ungrateful steward. And he tells that story of the one servant who owed so great a debt he would never be able to pay it, and the master forgives the debt outright, and then he goes out and won't even forgive a smaller debt offered to him. And the master calls him back in and tells him he has to repay the debt. So it will be with you, Jesus said, if you do not forgive others their sins. I did some figuring. Now, someone could probably correct me on this, but this was my figuring. I wanted to see how much that first servant owed. And it said that Jesus said he had 10,000 talents of silver that was owed, right? So the current price of silver is $17.95 an ounce. And there's 16 ounces in a pound, is that correct? So that'd be $287 for a pound of silver today. Is that sound right? One talent was equal to 18 pounds of silver. That would be about $5,166 for one talent. But Jesus said there were how many talents in the gospel today? 10,000 talents were owed. That would be worth $51,660,000. Do you get the size of the debt? Do you get it? When he was freed from that debt, he went outside and there was a servant that owed him 100 denarii. That's 100 days' wage. Figuring a servant would have been making, let's just say, minimum wage. Is that fair? Today's minimum wage nationally is $7.25 an hour. Multiply that. Let's say a 12-hour day, which would have been more typical. That would be $87 a day times 100. $8,700 was owed to him. Versus $51 million that had been forgiven him. Do you hear the difference? And one who had been forgiven $51 million could not find it in his heart to forgive $8,700. The debt owed to us doesn't compare what we have and what has been forgiven. In World War II, there were Scottish POWs in the Pacific, in a Japanese prison camp, and they did a count of the shovels at a prescribed time, and one shovel was missing. And the Scottish soldiers were all threatened unless somebody, the guilty party, stepped forward. A man stepped forward, and he was executed. When the time came for the next counting of the shovels, they found that all the shovels were there, and that there had been a miscount. And all of the Scottish prisoners realized what this fellow prisoner of theirs had done to step forward and to give his life for the sake of everybody. After the war, after they were freed, there were reprisals. And they were asked, was there any scores that need to be settled? And in the back of a lot of their minds, they immediately thought of this. But their answer was this: no more hatred, no more killing. What we need now is forgiveness. In light of such sacrifice that they had known, what proper response was there than to offer forgiveness? And we find in forgiveness that forgiveness delivers the one who is forgiving. I heard a story years ago about a young boy and girl who went to visit their grandparents on a farm. They were going to spend a couple of weeks there, and the grandfather took the grandson out and made him a slingshot. The grandmother said, "Don't you make that boy a slingshot. You know that he's going to hit something he shouldn't be shooting at." And he said, "Ah, every boy needs a slingshot." So he made him a slingshot and shot it at a can. It worked real well. And Johnny, the little boy, was very excited. And he says, "Now, you can go shoot anything you want, but don't shoot at anything alive. Don't shoot at any windows. Don't shoot at anything you ought not to be shooting at. Promise? 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 Promise?" So he ran out and began to shoot tin cans off of fences. He shot at trees. He shot at this and that. And he got very good at shooting that slingshot. And then he saw it across the pond. Grandmother's prize rooster, he saw it. And he just was excited. He just couldn't quite control himself as he pulled back the slingshot, and he knew he could hit it, and he let go. And just as he let go, you know how everything sometimes goes in slow motion, you know. And as he let it go, he could hear himself going, no. But his aim was true, and it hit the rooster. And the rooster fell over dead. And he ran around to the rooster, and he tried to revive it, and he's crying, don't die, Mr. Rooster. And then he looked around to see if anybody was watching. Nobody out here. I'll hide the evidence. So he took the rooster, and he went over to the wood pile, and he pulled some logs aside, and he began to dig a hole. And he's still crying, and there's mud under his fingernails and dirt on his face, and he buries the chicken, and he puts the dirt on top, and he puts the logs, and he says a prayer, and he stands, and he feels much better. And he feels like, I've gotten away with it. And he turns, and there he sees, tapping her foot, his sister. And he knows that she's seen everything. Don't tell, don't tell. Oh, I won't tell, she said. I won't tell. So that night at supper, it was time to clean the dishes, and the grandmother said, Amy, help me clean up the dishes. She said, I will. But you know, Johnny was saying that he wanted to help you tonight, Grandma. Yeah, let me do it. Let me do it. Amy, would you please take out the trash when we're done? I will. Johnny said, no, let me do that. Let me do it. And so on, this went on for 3 or 4 days. And finally, he couldn't take it anymore. He couldn't take it. And he went to his grandmother and he said, Grandma, I've got to tell you something. It's bad. It's bad. But you know that rooster disappeared of yours. And I got to tell you, I accidentally killed it. I killed it. And she said, I know. He said, you know? She said, I was standing in the kitchen window and watched when you did it. And he said, then why didn't you tell me that you knew? And she said, I wanted to see how long you were willing to be a slave of your sister. The grandmother wasn't the victim in losing that rooster, because she'd already practiced forgiveness. Without forgiveness, the young man simply became a slave of guilt and the great debt that weighed on his conscience. If only he had gone sooner, he could have been free. But the parable also teaches us that we don't know if a person truly accepts the forgiveness they've been offered unless they are ready to offer that forgiveness to someone else. Because forgiveness is redeeming for everybody involved. The servant in the parable didn't find redemption because he had not truly appreciated what had been done for him. He did not faithfully, in response to the master, respond to the servant of his own. And in so doing, he failed to find redemption and failed to offer freedom to another human soul. Corrie ten Boom was a Dutch woman who survived the Holocaust. She lost her family, but she survived the Holocaust and used to preach of God's work in her life during that time and after. And she told the story once about having offered forgiveness to somebody. But she talked to her pastor and said, you know, Pastor, I've offered forgiveness, but I don't know if it's true, because still inside I harbor these feelings of anger. Although I in my heart I've forgiven, but I still have these feelings from time to time. And she said the pastor told her something she never forgot. He said, Corrie, if you pull on a rope and ring a bell for a long, long time, you can let go of the rope, but it's still going to take some time for that bell to stop ringing. But over time, it'll stop. And she recognized in her own life, as she was able to offer forgiveness to others, that over time, that anger subsided in her own soul. And she wrote this. She said, "To forgive someone else is to free a human soul and to realize that the soul you free is your own." Is your own. Jesus teaches us that as his followers, we must forgive others. That in the manner in which we forgive others, we will be forgiven. And as forgiveness is difficult, we remember that debts owed to us cannot compare to what we owe our Father in heaven. And we find that when we forgive others, it frees us and is redeeming to everybody involved. Yes, it can be very difficult. At times it might even seem impossible. But like God did for the Israelites, God acts in the faithful response of God's people to bring deliverance for all who would call upon his name. "We're on number 8 now, Timothy," the teacher said. "Catch up." Peter, I believe Jesus was saying, Peter and all of us who need to practice forgiveness, we're not on 7 anymore, Peter. We're on 70 times 7. And we're still going. Catch up. Catch up. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our final hymn is on 390. "Forgive our sins as we forgive," being reminded of what our Father has done for us in Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit. As we sing, let it be a prayer that we offer up to God, a prayer of thanksgiving for what God has done for us, and indeed a prayer that we might do the same for others. Let us stand as we sing.